Edithon, how he says, he kind of hichilema, how kind of hichilema did not, sorry, I'm blind. How kind of hichilema did not explain. Listen to what he says.
Minister of Finance. I was Minister of Agriculture, I was Minister, I would deal with the two ministries. Now, you see, he says he was young. I want to say from the outset, this is why government has created the Katombola Defamatory for young criminals. It is not because you are young that you cannot be a criminal, but Katombola Reformatory is there for people who are young. So the story of him being young is not there. I want to say that the behavior of Hagar in the Hichilema is equivalent to Nabal in the Bible. My and goodness. I draw him to 1 Samuel chapter 25, verse 1 to 42, the story of Nabal and David. Nabal is, in the Bible, is a very rich man, but he lacks wisdom, he's self-conceited, he doesn't respect anyone, he doesn't create any relationships. When he opened his statement on air radio station, one would expect that at this point of development where we are, the age, we need to create developments. If he has been lucky not to be booked by the Anti-Corruption Commission, he should just keep quiet because he colors, should say he's lucky. Of agriculture,
just look.
You asked him for my loan.
That's not quality.
We wanted to restructure Lima Bank and we gave Grant Thornton the opportunity to advise government on receivership. Mind you, on receivership, they went ahead and did a liquidation of Lima Bank. Now, I just want to is he able to produce the bid and the price which gave him the house in Sevo Road where he's been residing until we moved to Mukamuya in Lusaka East. Okay. This is the Lima Bank house.
Okay.
Under our current laws and even previous laws, that is theft and that's corruption.
Wow.
You cannot give a public officer, and you are not a public officer just because you are in government.
Wow.
He was an advisor to government.
Mm.
So to the extent that Grant Thornton was a receiver for mm-hmm. him, and Hakainde alienates a house to himself, that is theft.
Wow.
He's lucky he hasn't gone to Katombola.
You are lucky.
Visited him.
You are lucky. You haven't gone to Katombola.
Under my watch as Minister of Finance,
okay.
We were selling Intercontinental Hotel in Livingstone.
And
the foreigners were there. He brought them as the advisor. And when they had stood up, I said, Mr. Ichilema, do you think this $6 million is a fair price for the government? He's a professional, he's young, and it's not wrong to trust a young mind. You think that these are Zambians, as the late Ronald Benza put it, let us use our fellow Zambians to advise. You think that this is a Zambian who has the interest of the country at heart? His answer was, yes, Madam Minister. The price of $6 million for Intercontinental Hotel in Livingstone is a fair price. Mm-hmm. I mean, he says I was sleeping. Thieves come when you're sleeping. That's why they break in, they come with guns. However, the very next day, when we had finished the transaction on Intercontinental Hotel and it had moved to be Southern Sun, Mr. Hichilema became the chairperson of the new owners. Isn't that a conflict of interest? And there are further stories. You talk of Ramco's receivership. There were issues. These are the issues that people want him to clarify. At what point did he become a millionaire and even start to have money in foreign accounts?
Explain more on when it comes to, Intercontinental Hotel in the southern province. So when he said the $6 million is okay, so
I mean
he told you what he thought was right. So what was wrong with that?
There was nothing wrong with it.
Mm-hmm.
What is wrong is that the very next day, he becomes part and parcel of the people who have bought the asset. He didn't declare that he would have an interest.
What was the deep wrong then?
Look, that's the point I made, that he's lucky if he hasn't been probed. So he shouldn't start to verify others and say Edith Nwaku was sleeping. I mean, if we trusted him to do these jobs as a Zambian, doesn't mean we were all shocked and surprised that you could actually use both sides and jump this side and that side. I think that's conflict of interest. That's not acceptable. It's something that is not acceptable. Then you come to the issue of ramparts on the copper belt. They were the receivers. They should tell the public and say, this is what we did, this is how we got our money, and this is where we got the millions. Prior to privatization, how much money did Mr. Againde have? He should say that. Prior to him moving to Savo Road, where was he living? What is the value of that house that he got from Lima Bank? How much did he pay? Where was the bid advertised? Was it a solicited bid within their firm? All those issues become issues of explanation. But as I said, you see, if you refer to 1 Samuel 25, 1 to 42, there are people even in the Bible who have this attitude that when they have money, no one else matters. They are useless. Even in Naboth, he said that David was not a good person. He even refused to give food to David's invoice and said, look, I can't give you food. It was just himself. And this idea of thinking that you are the most intelligent and no one else has any brains, I think that is self-defeating. Againde must learn that building bridges and making relationship is important in politics. Each time that they on their side open their statements to talk about me, it's either no, Nwaku is going to be Minister of Finance for Lungu, no, Nwaku is now defected. I have even been appointed by websites like Kosowe Party. This is in their attempt to try and bring others down. And this should stop, because really, when people ask, all that is required is for the president of UPND to say, listen, I got my wealth like this, and this is where I started, and this is where I am. It's no need for him to get angry, because everyone can bring out their notebooks.
Okay, this is what he said when it comes to privatization.
The people who saw the money were the MMP government. They are there, they are still alive. Mr. Chikwane is alive. Edith Nwaku is alive. They are all there. I was 29, 30 years old. I've said this before. Remember, Mwaji was 29, 30 years old. It's Jama Maini, which belongs to the government. Mwaji Kwee, Mwaji Shikula. Mwaji Kwee, Mwaji Kwee, Mwaji Shikula.
That's a valid question from him. Mom, I mean, were you sleeping? How was he allowed? If at all you got away with murder, who's to blame?
I think that it's very, very important to understand that he says one thing there, that he was very young.
No, he says and that
because he was young, he couldn't be caught. That's why I'm saying that he's lucky.
I don't think that's what he said.
If he was young, that's why we have Katombora.
I know.
The question I ask him today is very clear. I am saying he got the house in Savo Road without declaring that he was doing a misdemeanor. Now, if he hasn't been arrested by the law, he hasn't been visited, well, he should continue to say that is Mwalikwis. Now, you can't say, I have stolen because the owners are sleeping and go boasting around. I think that's totally unacceptable. Can he actually tell us the bid price for the house in Savo Road, how much he paid, and why they, as Grand Tonton, who were the receivers, ended up sharing the houses with among themselves? Those are issues. So when you say he wasn't visited, because in this country, the only corrupt people are those in government. Those who are outside looting, using government means. I never followed. I think you saw that when we left as MMD, a lot of my colleagues were in jail, were sent where. Even now, the people who are being followed are those in government. Those who were advising government have never been in US dollars as receivers for RAMCOs. If that was given to the secretary, to the treasurer, or to the minister of finance, you think they would have survived and go 2 years later and say, no, they have money in offshore accounts which they can't explain? What type of business does Mr. Hakainde had to be able to have millions of dollars in offshore accounts which he declares? Now, this gentleman, the president of UPND, does not only end here in these assets. He goes even in the villages. There's a person in Zimba who had a stroke, I think, about last year or the other year. They leased a farm in Kalomo to Hakainde Hichilema as a business. And he goes back to them and says, you people, I've paid you, but the rent. So the rent is equivalent to the sale. The stroke. These are some of the issues. If you look at Naminwe area where he just arrived and grabbed land for his own grazing, how can you do that? I mean, as a commercial farmer, you can't be saying that you're a rich man, but you are grabbing communal grazing land. Because commercial farmers that we have seen, they grow grass to feed their animals. You can't be saying you have 29 farms and yet you are grazing on communal land. A commercial farmer has to grow grass to feed their animals. We have farmers here, just here around us from ZRC. They graze in one area. You see them bedding grass to feed the animals. Have you ever seen Mr. Hichilema bedding grass? His way of raising money is to pride on the communal land. And I don't have time for. So if someone has been lucky and the law has not visited him, one day the law will visit them. Because people will go to him and say, tell us how you acquired this house, this asset, that. 27, he says he was 29. He was 29, he had no cow at the time. How then did he end up after privatization being such a rich man? That's the only question that people want to know. That's all. I mean, he needs to be firm enough to come to the public and say, this is my history of my wealth. I bought one animal, I got this farm, I multiplied, and this is how I've been. I was living in this house before I moved to Savo Road, and how did I get this house? Explain. And you understand, Zambians are very forgiving. But please, this issue is like a boil. It continues to fester until we can squeeze it. And the only way is not to behave like Donald Trump and hide your records. The best way is to be open and tell the public, educate them. Look, we were receivers on RAMCOs, this is what we did.
These were the reports. Anyway, I'm gonna stop. The live broadcast. But my take on this one is that, much as I have issues with HH, I also have issues with the Nawakwi and all those that were in government at that point, because surely, like she has said herself, that. HH told them that Intercontinental in Livingstone is costing $6 million. If she didn't agree, if she had any doubt, why didn't they do a due diligence? Why did they trust HH to do everything? Why not check whatever he's doing? Because when you employ somebody, I mean, you need to check whatever they are doing. You can't just heap the blame on a consultant, because that consultant is supposed to be supervised by you. If you are not satisfied with the job that he's doing, you are supposed to question him. And Zach asked Vanawakwi a very valid question. Why didn't you do anything? Why didn't you take him on? Eh? And they can't answer that. So, in as far as I'm concerned, I agree with HH that yes, the Vadikui, they were sleeping.
HH saw that these people were sleeping and he took advantage. This is my conclusion. HH saw that the MMD government, the people that were in government at that point, including Vanawakubene, they were sleeping. But what he did was also wrong, because he took advantage of the situation because they were sleeping, and he enriched himself. For me, that is where I have an issue. Now, let me close my this live broadcast, because I'm doing something else. Thank you. Okay, go off.
That's not a valid reason.